radio, you must know Miss Leslie Gore. Welcome her.
Lollipops and rainbows, everything that's wonderful is what I feel when we're together.
Today, January 14th, 1952.
When you're near, the rain goes, disappears, dear, and I feel so fine just to know that you are mine.
Say my name and age?
Yeah.
My name is Patricia Alvarez. I'm 77 years old. I'm from Tennessee. I have five brothers, and I'm the only girl. We worked in the fields in Tennessee. Pick cotton, hoe cotton. I was 12 years old when I came to Chicago. We came up here to have a better life. We were outside. My brothers, all of us, we were outside. And these couple of guys that was hanging around, I knew them and everything. They were trying to throw me under the hydrant. We used to open them up in the summertime, and they were trying to throw me under the hydrant, and here he comes and saves me, and he gets them away from me. That's how it started from there. It was real good looking. In Osco, Puerto Rico. He lived a block away from me, and he started hanging out with my brothers. Before we even met, he was going around telling everybody that I was the one that he was gonna marry before we were even together. When he hung out at my house, my father thought that he was there because of my brothers, hanging out with my brothers. You know, but he was really there to see me. 16, we were together for about a year, and then we got engaged. We were still in high school, you know, so we were engaged. Through high school. When we were 18, we eloped. First, we went to City Hall. We thought it was only gonna cost $10. And then we found out it was gonna be $20. This other man, he just got ordained. He was a pastor. He was 18 years old. And we went to his house that night with him and his wife. And we got married at his house. We were the first ones he married. We hid it from my father, you know. Mm-hmm. My father didn't know, otherwise he would have stopped it. His parents didn't know either till he found a job and we got an apartment. Then we went and told my father that we got married. He didn't speak to me for about a year.
How old were you when you got pregnant with Mom?
19.
I remember my grandpa a little bit. I mean, I was still very young, and from what I understand, he didn't care for me very much. And, you know, she used to tell me he wouldn't hold me or nothing like that. Now, my grandma, she was just crazy about me, and, you know, grandma just didn't care. But grandpa, he was an old-fashioned guy from, you know, southern Tennessee, and that's just how it was. I remember going over there because Mama and Papa, they had to go somewhere. They had to attend something, so I had to spend the night. I think it was something for his baseball. I was crying and I was screaming and I didn't want them to go, and Grandma Leslie was trying to hold me, and you know, I remember Grandpa not wanting me to be there. And I think that's why I was crying so much. I mean, I was crying because they were leaving, but I knew that he didn't want me there. But then after a while, you know, because I would be there all the time then, and I would always want to sit on his lap. I'm just a little girl. And then eventually he warmed up to me.
Liz was only 3 months old when I got pregnant with Uncle T.
Hey there, my name is Tony Alvarez. I am the son of Patricia and Raymond Alvarez, the brother to Liz.
She used to dress us the same as twins.
I grew up in an Irish neighborhood. I think we were like one of only two Puerto Rican families in the neighborhood.
He started performing in garage bands when he was like 12 years old. He started getting interested in the music.
A couple of brothers, they played the guitar a little bit and sing a little bit. But Uncle T, he just more or less just learned it on his own.
Once I started playing music, he was just proud. He would come to all my shows and just sit there and beam. Is it like a proud dad?
One time we were out and because one place he was playing, and he brought me up on stage, and that was the very first time ever. And my dad happened to be there because my dad was a big fan. And he brought me up on stage, and I was just so nervous. And then we had a great time. And that was the one and only time my dad ever got to see me perform. And he was just so proud.
And pretty much everything I did, you know, he was just always so proud of me and my sister.
If he had a couple of drinks in him, he'd dance. If he didn't, he wouldn't dance.
He was my dancing partner. If I wanted to dance and Uncle T didn't feel like dancing, you know, they used to try to get him to go out there, you know, get out there and dance. But he didn't want to. Papa would always go out there and dance with me. We used to go to for Thanksgiving. We used to go to his side of the family for Puerto Rican Thanksgiving, and they always played salsa music.
He always was into sports. He was a baseball player.
As a child, he would, you know, taught me how to play baseball.
He used to travel to Puerto Rico because he played for a lot of the Spanish teams.
He would come to all my baseball games in high school. He'd come to my basketball games.
He was real good at baseball. He was very good.
And in the wintertime, he was a bowler.
Bowling alley with all my relatives from my father's side on the Puerto Rican side.
We used to go to Puerto Rico just visiting his parents and his family over there.
We were in the mountains of Puerto Rico. I remember, you know, things just flying in the windows and then, you know, flying out the other window. And my grandma, we called her Mamita. She, you know, she wouldn't think anything about it.
My dad spoke good Spanish.
Mama would always encourage him to teach us to talk Spanish, but because we didn't speak it at home, we kind of learned just from listening, going to the relative's house and stuff. And I think that's how we kind of learned how to pick it up.
My kids were very good. Very good. I never had no problems with my kids. No drinking problems, no drugs, no nothing. They were very good kids. Papa worked at Electromotives. They made trains instead of cars.
He was a hard worker. He always worked. I think that's probably where I got my work ethic from.
I remember him, he used to get off at 2 o'clock in the morning, and I always want to stay up and wait for him, but you know, I couldn't. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, I'm a little kid. And on the very rare occasions, once in a while, Mama would let us, you know, she would wake us up at like midnight or 1 o'clock. We'd have a little bitty tiny TV on the kitchen table, and we used to wait for Papa to get home. So I remember when he used to come home in the middle of the night and see me sitting there at the kitchen table with Mama, I go, what are you doing up? And I used to just love it.
He worked there for 22 years. He had 2 years ago before he retired, and that's when he passed away. He had cancer at one time, but he was in remission. There was a few things that was wrong with him at the time. 1997. He was 53 years old.
When we were at the hospital, you know, he couldn't talk anymore, but he was conscious. But he couldn't really talk. And I remember me and Dad going to the hospital, and we were in the room, and we were visiting with him, and I was holding his hand, and you know, he acted like he wanted to say something. He kept doing his face like he wanted to say. He says, "You want to say something, Daddy?" I called him Daddy. "You want to do something? Want to say something, Daddy?" He would just kind of raise his eyebrows. And I go, "Oh," I go, "you love me." You know, I was making a joke out of it. And his eyebrows went real big, so I knew he was trying to say that. And then Daddy took his hand. He goes, "Don't worry." He goes, "I'm going to take care of her." Mm-hmm. He did.
Once he started getting sick and diagnosed with cancer, I wrote a song for him. It's called Ode to My Dad. Ode, O-W-E-D, not O-D-E, because I felt like I owed a lot to my father.
Remember the night before he passed, we used to sleep in the hospital the first, you know, the last few nights. We knew that we had to stay there. We couldn't leave. So we used to sleep at the hospital. And the night before he passed, I used to sneak in the room, you know, without Mama and stuff, and go in there and just kind of hold his hand because I knew he could hear me, and just kind of keep him company. I didn't want him laying in there by himself. And I went in there and I was holding his hand and I was talking to him. I don't know if he could hear me, I'm hoping he can. I was talking to him and I was holding his hand, and I put my head on his hand. I fell asleep. And I remember Mama coming in the room about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. She says, "You can't sleep here like this," because I was, you know, in an uncomfortable position. She said, "You can't sleep here like this. I want to sleep here." So I did. I held his hand. I fell asleep. I woke up the next morning and, you know, we got our breakfast, and that day he passed away. So I'm glad that I got to do that. I remember when I went to bed that night, I had a dream.
He came to me in a dream.
But it was one of those dreams that were so real.
I hugged him.
And the hug felt real. And
he said, "Everything's okay."
And he goes, "It's going to be okay."
He smiled.
His voice felt real. Everything about it felt real.
Is there like any time or, I don't know, like any events that happened, like where you felt like Papa was here?
Oh, he's always here. Always.
Yeah, he's with me all the time. Because when I think about him and when I talk to him and stuff, I know I can still feel his presence.
My son, Brendan, he wasn't even a year old. He didn't speak. You know, he just made baby noises. I walked into my mother's home with Brendan in my arms. And as soon as my mom came around the corner, Brendan went, "Hey, Babo." It's because my father used to call my mom Babo.
He's always in my head, always in my mind. And in my heart, I think of him all the time.
It's your dad, and you never, you know, somebody that's taking care of you as a baby, even if they're gone for 5 years or 50 years, you never forget. And certain things you do, certain things you hear, you just always feel their presence. We went to the same movie theater, but we didn't know it at the time because, you know, he was with his friends, I was with my friends. We didn't know each other. We were complete strangers, like somebody you'd see out on the street. After we met, you know, when we were older, we worked at the same place, and that's how we met. And I used to see pictures of him when he was younger. And I was like, "You look so familiar." And then he told me he used to go to the Brighton Theater all the time. I said, "I used to go to the Brighton Theater all the time." So now when I look at his pictures, I think, "I knew you when I was 16 years old. I knew you, but we didn't know each other." You know, I can tell from when I remember seeing him. I remember seeing him all over in Brighton Park. I got married. Uncle T walked me down the aisle, and I was just, you know, after Daddy telling him that he would take care of me, I just, you know, I always told Uncle T, I said, I wish Daddy was here to walk me down the aisle. I said, because, you know, I want him here. So I remember, I kept saying that. And so on my wedding day, when I got out of the limousine, I got into the church, you know, in the back, this before anything started. And Uncle T says, "I want you to come outside with me." I go, "We're going to start soon." He goes, "We got a little time." He says, "Come outside with me." So we went outside and we got in the limo and we were sitting in the back. And, you know, he started crying and started saying, "You know, I know that you said you want Daddy to walk you down the aisle, but he can't be here." And, you know, he was telling me how honored he is to be doing it. And then he gave me this little heart, this little locket. And he said, "Open it." It was my dad. He put it on me. He goes, "Well, Daddy, you're walking down the aisle." He did. So Papa walked me down the aisle.
I've lost all my brothers. Yeah. I'm the only one that's left.
You know, treat every day like it is the last day, because it may be one time and you're going to say, "Oh, I wish I would have said that," or "I wish I would have done that." So don't wish it. Do it now, because then you'll have nothing to regret. And that's my life.
Good job.
Every time I think of him, I smile. I have no bad memories of my father.
After all these years, I only have 2 kids, a boy and a girl, but I have 11 grandchildren. I don't know how that happened. I just thank the Lord for everything I have and all the people that I have in my family. I love my family.
Good.
So, adios.
Adios.